There are no exact figures for the numbers of child soldiers used by the Sudan People's Liberation Army. But since 2001, more than 20,000 have been demobilized.
I believe I've survived for a reason to tell my story to touch lives. I believe I've survived for a reason to tell my story to touch lives. All people struggling down there. Storms only come for a while, then after a while, they'll be gone. Bless, bless. My father was working for the government as a policeman. Few years later, I heard he joined a rebel movement that was formed to fight for freedom. I didn't understand the politics behind all this, cause I was only a child. After a while, I saw the tension rising high between the Christian and the Muslim regime. We lost our possession. My mother suffered depression. And because of this, I was forced to be a war child.
Emmanuel Jal was born in southern Sudan and spent the early years of his childhood in the midst of its long-running civil war. At the age of 7, after the death of his mother, he was recruited as a child soldier for the rebel army. Amazingly, he survived frontline action and eventually managed to escape with 300 other lost boys. He endured a 3-month trek on foot without any supplies to reach safety. One of only a handful to survive the journey, Emmanuel was rescued by Emma McCune, a British aid worker, who smuggled him to freedom in Kenya and enrolled him in school for the first time.
This one goes to Emma McCune, angel to the rescue one afternoon. I'm here because you rescued me. I'm proud to carry your legacy. Thank you. Bless you. R.I.P.
What would I be?
Our mission is to work with individuals, families, and communities to help them overcome the effects of war and poverty through education. Our objectives are the advancement of education for the public benefit by providing and assisting in the provisions of facilities for education. The relief of financial hardship, in particular but not exclusively by the provision of education and vocational training. And the relief of need of orphans by providing or assisting in the provision of items, services, and facilities.
And the children are desperate to learn. These children have walked hundreds and hundreds of miles in search of schools. And they often do not ask for food, they ask for a pen, a book and a pencil.
Gua Africa supports a number of young people who survived against unimaginable odds and have been living in the harsh conditions of Kakuma refugee camp in northwest Kenya. Some fought as child soldiers in Sudan, and 2 survived the genocide in Rwanda, which claimed the lives of both of their parents. Gua links them with sponsors who pay for their educational fees, and they are provided with safe accommodation and emotional support at our base in Nairobi. John's mother died of cancer when he was 7 years old. His father was a doctor and died fighting for the SPLA in 1989. Along with many other children, John was taken to Ethiopia to be educated, but in the process they were also trained as child soldiers. When the government of Ethiopia was overthrown, they trekked back to Sudan. The children had no food and could only feed on leaves and roots. After the new government came to power, the Sudanese refugees were recalled, and as the boys trekked back to Ethiopia, their area was attacked by Sudanese government forces. By that time, John was only 8 years old. In the refugee camp in Ethiopia, John was lucky enough to attend primary school and began receiving his education. Lucy was born in 1991 in a town near the border with Uganda and Kenya. The war reached Lucy at an early age and soon claimed the lives of both of her parents. Lucy and her younger siblings were taken in by her grandmother, but as the fighting intensified, she and her younger brothers decided to flee to the refugee camp in Kenya. They arrived at the Kakuma refugee camp in 1999, and life quickly became incredibly tough for Lucy. Aged just 8, She was the oldest of the family and therefore had to take responsibility for her younger brothers. Security, lack of basic needs such as daily food, were a constant worry, but thankfully she was able to attend the camp's primary school and begin her education.
So yeah, the last time I came here, the thing I remember the most is the smell from the bats. It was just terrible. And these two rooms here, the ceilings had collapsed completely.
Hello, mama. The last time I saw you was when I was seven. I had the news that you were taken to heaven. The soldier said in a way that is soft so that I would know that you have died. I cried and I cried and I asked God why. The worst part when we capsized in the ship. I saw parents coming running for their kids. As for me, no one did. Running from the war-torn city of Banti, I remember you. But here I am, mama. Here I am, mama. Wish you could see me now. Hope you're up in the cloud, looking down, feeling proud.
You know, we constructed the security fence, which is all around the outside. Before it was completely open, so animals, this corridor through here that you see was full of cow and goat excrement everywhere, so it was a real hygiene problem. You've seen the men digging the toilet blocks, yes? Yeah. So we're hoping that work can be finished soon, and then the next thing will be to build you some new classrooms outside. So just keep working hard, and we'll keep working hard to help you as much as we can.
The Mary John Primary School has just over 1,000 students. They have no concrete classroom structures in which to be taught. All lessons take place outside, under the trees, with no separation between each class and the day-to-day goings-on of Lear taking place around them.
The excavation of the first ever borehole funded by Gua Africa here in Lear, Unity County.
For the Mary John Primary School.
According to the international NGO World Vision in 2010, there are only 33 secondary schools in the whole of southern Sudan, a region of some 640,000 square kilometers, or almost 250,000 square miles. Gua Africa has been granted 15 acres of land in Lear by the government of southern Sudan. Our goal is to build a high-quality education center for the whole community, which is to be called the Emma Academy, as a legacy to Emma McCune, who lies at rest in Lear.
So she's saying she's really excited and very happy that all the children that went away, that were taken away, they have come with some knowledge. And now they have come to volunteer to actually put the kids in school. And one of our children, which is me, now they have to support our children so they're able to make everything happen for them in the future, for them to support them. Imagine they're trying to build a temporary school in each one of small boxes, like $2,000 to
construct. We find ourselves pushed to extremities of circumstances, where our natural survival instincts governs our actions, which forces us to do things that we under normal circumstances would consider to be human and barbaric. But when the choices are to kill or be killed, steal or be stolen, eat or be eaten, then what can we do when we are forced to seem to make a living?